As we prepare for the procession of the graduates and faculty to enter the assembly, we ask you to please turn off all cell phones, pagers, and beepers for the duration of the Baccalaureate Mass. If you require any assistance during the liturgy, please see one of the commencement staff members. Thank you for your cooperation.
Thank you. Good afternoon, everyone. It is my distinct pleasure to welcome each and every one of you today. The University of Scranton has a strong liturgical tradition, and we, as members of the university family, have come together often throughout these years to offer praise and thanksgiving to God, as well as to pray for one another. It is fitting, therefore, at this time of great promise, that we gather once again with you, our family and friends, to celebrate the liturgy. I invite you to join us in word, in song, and in prayer for one another. Please sing our gathering song, Canticle of the Sun, found in your program.
Thank you. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. My sisters and brothers, the grace and peace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with each one of you. Good afternoon and welcome to our Baccalaureate Mass. It is appropriate that at the beginning or the continuation of these commencement ceremonies that we gather in Eucharist, which means Thanksgiving, to ask God and to praise Him, to thank Him. It's also appropriate that we meet during the liturgical season between Ascension and Pentecost. We pray for the coming, the indwelling of the Holy Spirit among our graduates. Let us pause for a brief moment and prepare ourselves to celebrate this Eucharist. Lord Jesus, you are the way, the truth, and the life. Lord, have mercy. Christ Jesus, you come to your people in word and sacrament. Christ, have mercy. Lord Jesus, you sit at the right hand of God interceding for your people. Lord, have mercy. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to life everlasting.
Amen. Glory to God in the highest. Glory to God. And on earth, peace to people. To people of goodwill.
Let us pray. Graciously hear our supplications, O Lord, so that we who believe that the Savior of the human race is with you in your glory may experience as he promised until the end of the world his abiding presence among us, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. After Jesus had been taken up to heaven, the apostles returned to Jerusalem from the mount called Olivet, which is near Jerusalem, a Sabbath day's journey away. When they entered the city, they went to the upper room where they were staying, Peter and John and James and Andrew, Philip and Thomas, Bartholomew and Matthew, James, son of Alphaeus, Simon the Zealot, and Judas, son of James. All these devoted themselves with one accord to prayer, together with some women and Mary, the mother of Jesus, and his brothers. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad.
This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad.
A reading from the first letter of St. Peter. Beloved, rejoice to the extent that you share in the sufferings of Christ, so that when his glory is revealed, you may also rejoice exultantly. If you are insulted for the name of Christ, blessed are you, for the Spirit of glory and of God rests upon you. But let no one among you be made to suffer as a murderer, a thief, an evildoer, or as an intriguer. But whoever is made to suffer as a Christian should not be ashamed, but glorify God because of the name. The word of the Lord.
be with you.
With
a reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. Jesus raised his eyes to heaven and said, Father, the hour has come. Give glory to your Son, so that your Son may glorify you, just as you gave him authority over all people, so that your Son may give eternal life to all you gave him. Now this is eternal life, that they should know you, the only true God, and the one whom you sent, Jesus Christ. I glorified you on earth by accomplishing the work that you gave me to do. Now glorify me, Father, with you, with the glory that I had with you before the world began. I revealed your name to those whom you gave me out of the world. They belong to you, and you gave them to me, and they have kept your word. Now they know that everything you gave me is from you, because the words you gave to me, I have given to them. And they accepted them and truly understood that I came from you, and they have believed you sent me. I pray for them. I do not pray for the world, but for the ones you have given me, because they are yours, and everything of mine is yours, and everything of yours is mine, and I have been glorified in them. And now I will no longer be in the world, but they are in the world, while I am coming to you. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise you, Lord Jesus Christ.
This room, although it's much bigger, is very much like the upper room that we just heard about in the first reading, where the disciples had gathered after the ascension, but before Pentecost. It's a room that is jammed with people, and it's a room jammed with hearts that are full. And we're like those folks in that upper room in a lot of ways, not the least of which is that we likely have in our hearts some of the same questions that they had in theirs. Think about what they had just been through. The ascension, sure, but before that, Holy Week, the suffering and death of Jesus, the resurrection of Jesus, appearances of Jesus, and before that, 3 long years. Or 3 short years of wandering with Jesus and listening to him and being amazed by him and learning from him. And you can be sure that as they sat there in their room, they must have said to themselves something like, these past few years, wait, what just happened? And what does it mean? These are their questions. And there are questions. They're your questions. With hearts that are full. And this room is filled with many different hearts, many different kinds of hearts, grandparents' hearts, aunts and uncles' hearts, friends' hearts. But I'd like to touch on 2 particular kinds of hearts that are powerfully full today. Parents' hearts and graduates' hearts. All of these hearts are here and all of them are full, and they're full of memories, and that's good. Because memories can be powerful channels of grace. So first, a word about parents' hearts. And I'll start with a story, because I suspect my experience is not all that unlike yours, in some ways. I'm one of six kids, and we try to gather at Christmas at my parents' house, although we can't always make it. But whoever shows up, we have similar rituals. And one of them is the first couple who get there have to pull out the ornament boxes for the tree and the family room and whatnot. And we go through them and go through them. And over the years, my siblings and I have given my parents some very expensive Christmas ornaments from Poland and Italy, these hand-blown things. They're really beautiful. These are not my mother's favorite ornaments. Every year we get to this one box, and it comes out, and there's tissue paper and bubble wrap. And we come to this embarrassing moment, for me at least, where she pulls out this thing, which is a toilet paper roll that has some pipe cleaners on it and some glitter that's stuck to globs of Elmer's glue and a couple shards of red construction paper. And that's it. And as I say, it's kind of a ritual at this point. I'll pick it up and say, Ma, what is this? Do you want me to throw it out? Oh, give it to me. It's a treasure. And she means it. And it turns out it's a Santa Claus ornament. And it turns out that I made it when I was in kindergarten in 1965. There is a part of my parents' brains and my parents' hearts that will always hold the five-year-old me. There ain't no way my mother is ever gonna throw out that toilet roll Santa. Now, I suspect you could tell a similar story in one way or another of your parents. That's the thing about parents. They remember stuff. And in their hearts, your parents carry memories of you. Of the felt in the bone joy they knew when you were born. And they brought you home to their home. Your home. They carry memories of the 10,000 ways that you made them smile and laugh through the years as you grew, incredibly, into a toddler and a kindergartner and a grade school kid and a high school kid and a freshman in college and, even more incredibly, into someone who is going to graduate from college tomorrow. Parents are memory keepers. And some of what they remember, they share. That's why you know so many stories. But some of what they remember, they don't share. Some of what they remember, they keep in their hearts, and they keep to themselves and between themselves, and between themselves and God. The silent worries when you were sick or hurt. The hidden sacrifices that made your growing up and your getting an education possible. The 10,000 ways they suffered because you suffered. As you grew up and learned, as humans do, by trial and error, in real families, which we all know are never perfect. They remember all of that and more. And today, I am sure they say, wait, these past years, not just four, but 21 or 22, what just happened? And what does it mean? These are disciple questions, and they're parent questions. They're questions of hearts that are full. But today, more. Today, they're the questions of young men and women on the verge of graduating from college, and whose memory-filled hearts say, wait, these past 4 years, what just happened? And what does it mean? Yes, students remember, and they remember powerfully. Ours is a species marked by remembering, at least when we're healthy and wise. So you graduates, here's a quiz for you, the last one of your college career. Here's a quiz. Call to mind, right now, images of the last 4 years, images that changed you, images of things that formed you into the person you are right now. Let those images come. I would be willing to bet that if we could project everyone's brain onto some screen and see what's in there, the images you're holding in your heart and in your mind right now are not images of textbooks or tests or quizzes. They're images of people and of experiences you shared with them. And that is exactly as it should be. Exactly as it should be. Now, does that mean that classes and tests and exams are not important? Of course they're important. We're a university. But they're important in a context. They're important in the context of the human being you are becoming. The life of the mind, yes, but in the context of the life of a human being. This is one of the differences of going to a school that is Catholic and Jesuit. Since the first day you stepped foot on this campus, we have cared and cared deeply not just about what you know, but about who you are and what kind of person you are. Not just the student, but the human being. And what we hope that you discovered here includes this, a rock-bottom basic truth about yourselves. You are built, hardwired for relationship. That's one of the most profound and basic ways that you are created in the image and likeness of God, who is love. It is in and through your relationships that you discover the truth about yourself, about other people, about God. Here's the deal. The quality of your life on earth and the quality of your life in eternity will depend entirely on the quality of your relationships. Your relationships with other people, and through them, your relationship with God. One of the truths that we discover as we live into adult faith is that the Spirit of God always calls us, every day calls us to broaden the circle of our concern, of our compassion, of our love. Every day, to widen our hearts, so that they include not just me and my family and friends, not just me and my church and my country, but the whole world and every person who lives in it, especially the poor and the marginalized. And we learn that best when we learn it together. You know that. You've lived it. That's one reason why the church is so important and why we invite you to anchor yourselves in our community of faith. We come to God best when we come to God together. God is more easily recognizable when we look for him together. God meets us in uniquely powerful ways when we seek him together. That's why the sacraments are so powerful. It's why it's not surprising if you felt particularly close to God on a service trip or on a retreat. Again, we are created for relationship, for family, for friendship, for citizenship. So, in these last 4 years, what happened? Well, what happened is you continued to grow up. Sometimes haltingly, but still you continued to grow up. But what does it mean? What does it mean? What do these last 4 years mean? What do these last 21, 22 years mean? Well, it means a lot of things, but it boils down to this. The meaning of life is love. Not the easy, shallow kind of love that many people try to sell us as the real thing. But the sturdier, soul-shaping sort of love that sustains marriages through decades and raises families through the ups and downs of a world that is broken but graced. The sort of love that sustained you through the trial and error obstacle course that we call growing up. The sort of love that is embodied in the family and friends who surround you this weekend. The meaning of life is love. So finally this. Our hope is that you have caught at least a glimpse of this truth during your 4 years here. Our prayer is that you will let it shape the rest of your life, so that when you come one day, as each and every one of us will, before the judgment seat of God, and God asks you, as he will each and every one of us, okay, show me your loves. Show me your loves. Our prayer is in that moment you will be able to spread your arms and open wide the doors to your deep heart and say, Lord, here they are. Here are my loves, and I thank you for them. And I thank you for teaching me early in my life, in my 20s, that in the end, three things last: faith, hope, and love. And the greatest of these is love. Blessed be God forever.
Let us now stand and together profess our faith. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary, and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended to heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end.
I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic Apostolic Church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Let us now join our prayers to Christ's eternal prayer to God for all the human family.
For our church and university community, that we may become a community of prayer and loving support to one another, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all those preparing for lives of service, those to be ordained, seminarians, novices, and all of our graduates who are embarking upon a period of long-term service, that they will find joy and fulfillment in their ministries, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the class of 2014, that they may continue to grow in wisdom and love of God, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the families and friends of our graduates, that they may be honored by the achievements of their loved ones, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the faculty and staff of the University of Scranton, who have blessed, encouraged, and accompanied the class of 2014, in gratitude to God for their wisdom and faith, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who have died, especially all those known to the class of 2014, that they may be raised up by the power of God's Spirit to the joy of eternal life, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the prayers we now make in the silence of our hearts, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Good and gracious God, hear the prayers of the people gathered together by your Son. May every prayer we utter and every work we undertake be to your glory as we await the fulfillment of your Easter promise of eternal life in you and he whom you have sent, Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you forever and ever.
Please join us as we sing the Supper of the Lord found in your program.
Precious body, precious blood, here in bread and wine. Here the Lord prepares a feast divine. Bread of love is broken now, cup of life is poured.
my sisters and brothers, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hand, the praise and glory of his name, for our good and for all of his holy church.
Accept, O Lord, the prayers of your faithful with the sacrificial offerings, that through these acts of devoutness, we may pass over to the glory of heaven through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For the Lord Jesus, the King of glory, conqueror of sin and death, ascended to the highest heavens as the angels gazed in wonder. Mediator between God and humankind, judge of the world and Lord of hosts, he ascended, not to distance himself from our lowly state, but that we, his members, might be confident of following where he, our head and founder, have gone before. Therefore, overcome with paschal joy, every land, every people exalts in your praise, and even the heavenly powers with the angelic hosts sing together the unending hymn of your glory as they acclaim. Indeed, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and, giving thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it. For this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember your church throughout the world, spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis our Pope, Joseph our Bishop, and all those who faithfully do your will. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on all of us, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with the blessed apostles, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. My friends, at the Savior's command and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be free from sin and safe from all distress, as we wait the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer one another the sign of peace.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy that I should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
Please be seated. Please wait until all the communion ministers are in place before proceeding to communion, and remain in your seats until a member of the commencement staff invites your row to communion. Please join us in singing Here in This Place.
Are not our hearts burning within us? Are not our lives shining?
Let us gather our voices as one in singing the Living Bread of God.
You, and we will live forever. Please join us in singing our song of thanksgiving, These Alone Are Enough.
Darkness falls on my final days. Take the very breath that sang your praise. Give me nothing more than your love and grace.
Let us pray. Hear us, O God, our Savior, and grant us confidence that through these sacred mysteries there will be accomplished in the body of the whole church what has already come to pass in Christ her head, through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Before our final blessing and dismissal, we have some announcements. The ministers, concelebrants, and the faculty will lead the graduating seniors out of the Byron following Mass. Guests are asked to remain in their places until all the seniors have exited. At the conclusion of the recessional, we must ask that all exit the Byron immediately in order that we may prepare the room for the next event. Families may reunite with their graduates in the area surrounding the Dion Green down by the DeNaple Center. Thank you.
Just allow me a few comments before we go. First of all, it's very important that the priests and the faculty get out first. Wouldn't you agree? I just want to thank a few folks here. First of all, I'd like to thank my Jesuit brothers for celebrating, for Deacon Anthony assisting, for our visiting clerics. Thank you very much. On the musical side, we can't but say great job to Jane Lucas and her team, Cheryl Boger and her team, and Robert Long on the music, or excuse me, on the organ. Please stand. I would like the entire assembly to join me in blessing the graduates. I invite everyone to extend their hands over the graduating students. Very good. Today, the Lord calls you to be the fire of the Holy Spirit sent forth as emissaries of God's truth. May God bless you with wisdom as you set out upon the path of life. And the congregation says, Amen. Today, the Lord calls you to be the strength of the Holy Spirit, sent forth as witnesses of God's unending love. May God grant you abundant joy in your loving service to others. The congregation says, Amen. Today, the Lord calls you to be light of the Holy Spirit, sent forth as people of hope amid the darkness of injustice and pain. May God gift you with understanding and compassion to lift up those in need. And the congregation says, Amen. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen.
Go in Our peace. Concluding song is found in your program.
Okay. Go in peace, glorifying the Lord by your life.
Thanks be to God.
Our concluding song is found in our program. Please join us as we sing We Are Called. Thank you.